Okay, everyone, we're going to get started. So thanks to everyone attending this joint seminar between Sizzle and ACOM. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Peter, who's coming to us sort of jointly from Colorado State University and University of Reading. So a little background. Peter did his undergraduate and sort of early graduate background in physics and astrophysics in the Netherlands, and then capped that off with a PhD in fluid dynamics from Delft University of Technology. He's then a professor at Utrecht University, and then became a professor at University of Reading in the UK, and was director of the Data Assimilation Division at the National Center for Earth Observation. And he has recently taken up a position at CSU's Department of Atmospheric Science as CSU starts to branch into data assimilation research. So Peter comes really recommended as a speaker for even a non-data assimilation familiar audience, because he really operates at the interface between the science and the modeling DA side. I think it's clear even from his educational background that he's got a strong appreciation for the underlying physics and how DA can improve simulations to support accurate modeling, but even how information moves around a physical system. I'm really excited to have Peter today because we're, at least in ACOM, really on the cusp of trying to engage data assimilation and leverage it for atmospheric chemistry. Not just forecasts, but also when we try to do things like upscale field campaign data and observations to form a broader picture of the Earth system, or to try to deal with all of the new information from the satellites that are coming on board in the recent years. So with that, I will let Peter take it away. Thank you.
So thank you, Nick, for the kind introduction. And thank you. Okay. I'm asked to start my video. Here we are. Thank you for the invitation. And to say something about data simulation for atmospheric chemistry. No further introduction is needed there. I guess I just go ahead. Why do we want to do data simulation for atmospheric chemistry? Well, there are several reasons, of course. We want to improve air quality forecasts, or forecasts in general, but also to reconstruct four-dimensional, meaning space and time, chemical, aerosol, concentration, evolution field, constrained by observations to better understand what's going on, and to, for instance, look at exposure levels over maybe a two-week period or things like that. Crucial, of course, is also estimating source and sinks, estimate model parameters, and a last thing is trying to really push systematic model improvement that hasn't happened too much, but the community has done parameter estimation, but to systematically improve model equations to kick some things out and put some new things in. That's what I'm thinking about. That has been the promise of data simulation for a very long time, and I think now we're really, really getting there, know how to do this, and so of course also highly important for atmospheric. It's interesting. I'm struggling slightly, but we're getting there. Okay, so let's move into data simulation. So this presentation will be about sort of fundamental data simulation and see how things are connected, moving into specific problems of atmospheric chemistry. And of course, you can only do so much. So in my abstract, I promised to talk about GeoSchem and to talk a bit about Tomcat as examples, but I'm afraid I didn't have time to put that in. So if you're really keen on that, then this is the time to leave. But let's talk about data simulation then. What is it? Well, it is the science, or maybe the art, of combining many sources of information. And in this case, specifically a numerical model. And the numerical model is important because it contains all we know about the system. Well, perhaps not everything we know, but everything that we can know about the system given the resolution at which we can run the model. And we combine that knowledge with all these observations that are out there, and especially with these geostationary satellites coming up with very high temporal resolutions, the number of observations is already astronomical, and it will just grow. And data simulation is an extremely efficient vehicle to combine all these different observations into numerical models and then make predictions, for instance. And these sources have their uncertainty. If let's say if the model was not uncertain, then didn't need the observations. The uncertainties are an integral part of this merger of information. And the most general way to incorporate these uncertainties is through probability densities. So this is an example of a probability density. I'm going very slow here just to try to make sure, mainly to get perhaps used to my notation. And suppose we have a concentration of a variable along the x-axis. You name it, and it's, let's say ppm, parts per million. And on the vertical axis, we have the probability density of that concentration. So what it means is that this probability density, what it means is, if I want to know what is the probability that my concentration is between 1/2 and let's say 1 ppm, then I have to just integrate this curve, the p of x, from 1/2 to 1. And that integral, that area under the line, give me the probability that the concentration is in that range. But the variable x can be anything. It can be the full state of the atmosphere. It can be a concentration field of, let's say, ozone. It can be a vector of sources and sinks, their position and their strength. It can be even be a trajectory over time of a concentration field. So it's sort of, if you like, a movie of what happened over a week. It can be specific model parameters, and it can be combinations of all of these. And so this is a completely general way of describing what's going on, and that's actually what we need and use daily in data simulation. Is x meaning different things? Now, we have to do some math, and we have to talk about conditional probabilities, probability densities, and conditional probabilities. I'm repeating myself. So, what is this? Well, if I have a joint probability of let's say x and y, two variables, then I can write it as a conditional probability x given y times the probability of y. So what that means is it sort of makes sense if you start talking in words. It's the probability of the random variable x that could be a model concentration field. And y is the observation of one of the species at a certain location, certain time, for instance, at a probability of x having a certain value. So your concentration field is at a certain, the values in that field have a certain value, and y, the observation, has a certain value. That probability is equal to the probability of that model concentration having a certain value given that observation. But then, of course, I have to still multiply. And so you see, we've lost a probability. The probability of y has left, because it's now a given quantity. So we have to multiply by this probability that the event, that I measure that specific value, that it actually occurs. And so then this is the definition of a conditional probability density. The joint probability density is the conditional probability density times what we call the marginal density. Can you see my mouse, by the way?
Yep, we can see it.
Okay, great. Now, this equation is symmetric. So the left-hand side, the left-hand side is symmetric in x and y. So we can also write this as the probability density of y given x times the probability of x. And since the two right-hand sides in these two equations are both equal to the joint probability density. We can combine them in this form written down in the last equation here that tells us the probability of x given y, etc. is the right-hand side. And the interesting thing is this is what data simulation is. This is what data simulation uses. This is all. If we would have a big enough computer, we wouldn't need common filters and 4D VAR and 4D ensemble VAR, whatever you want. We would just use this simple equation. And to put it in perspective, let's see what these things mean in our case. So this P of X, X is my model state, and that model state, I use it in a general sense. It could be, like I said, a vector of sources and sinks of CO, let's say. But it can be, like I said, it can also be an evolution of a concentration field over time, or the evolution of all the concentration fields and all the atmospheric variables that we have in our model, right? It can be all these things. But this is the information that comes from the model. And we call it the prior information. It's the information we start from. That's the information that this model is built over years and years, putting all the expertise in. So that is our prior knowledge before we see the observations. And the observations come in through this P of Y given X. Of course, the observations, I didn't stress it here for the model, but it's true for both observations and the model. They both come with uncertainties. So each of these red lines here is a probability density of the observation or the model. And of course, it's a probability density in a very high dimensional space. I don't know how to draw that, so I just do one dimension. And data simulation is then combining these two sources of information to get this so-called posterior PDF. And it is the probability density of the state of the system, the generalized state, let's call it, given these observations. And this is the solution. This is the thing we are after. This is what we want to know. And we want to know what is the probability of each possible state of the atmosphere given these observations. That is the solution to the data simulation problem. And you see in this equation here, on the right-hand side, we have the denominator still, P of Y. But P of Y, the observations are given. We have made these observations. So the P of Y is just a number. It's not one, by the way, right? It's something else. Some people write it. It's one in their publications, but it's not. But the thing is, it doesn't depend on the state. So actually, we don't need to worry about it. It's a normalization constant that we typically do not encounter in any calculation. So the solution to the data simulation problem is a PDF. And there's no inversion. A data simulation is not an inverse problem. It's a multiplication problem. We multiply the prior with the likelihood. And well, of course, you can use the word inversion if you like, but you see in its fundamental form, it is a multiplication problem. And if you're slightly lost now with all these probability densities, don't worry, we get back to more familiar territory later. But I'd like to say a bit more about this likelihood, because it looks a bit weird, right? You have the observation given the state. What is that? Why is that related to the observations? How does that work? And that works as follows. It's and again, there's a lot of confusion in the literature. So I want to try to explain to you what's really meant by this thing here. Why given X? It's a bit strange, guys. Because why the observations? We already have the observations. So this is not a probability density of Y. Y is a constant here. X is the variable, remember, in Bayes' theorem. X, the model state. And we want to know the probability density of each model state. So how should we look at this thing? How should we calculate it, for instance? Well, we have to remember where the observations come from. And the observations come from measuring the true atmosphere, the true atmospheric chemistry state, let's say. So that's X2. We don't know what it is, but we know we made a measurement of that system. And making the measurements, we denote it by this H here. So H For instance, if this is a, if X true is a full atmospheric field, and we do a measurement at one specific location, then this H, what it does, it just picks out from this full state, it just picks out the true value at that specific location. That's what this H does. And so this X is a typically very high dimensional vector. And this H, in this case, if I just make one observation at one position, this H just gets a number out of that large field at that specific location. Now, the trouble is that whatever measurement we do, we always have errors in these measurements. And everyone who's done observations in the lab or in the real world knows that there's no such thing as a measurement without an error. There's always electronic noise, or there's always something that disturbs this true value that we wanna find. And the how do we do this? So this equation here describes the measurement process. So we make a measurement of the true atmosphere, and then nature adds a random perturbation to it, the measurement error, and that gives us our observation. And what we have at our disposal then, after the measurement process, is these observations. And we typically assume that our instrument with which we do the measurement is well calibrated. And that means that we know the distribution, the probability distribution of these errors. Or we assume that we know it. So the instrument is, for instance, well calibrated. So it gives us an unbiased estimate. And the often we model the error in this measurement with the Gaussian. So n here is a normal, means Gaussian, normal distribution with mean zero and error covariance r, for instance. But the thing is that we assume that in data simulation, we assume that we know these quantities. In general, we know this p of epsilon. And that, like I said, just comes from the calibrated instrument. If you have a well calibrated instrument, then they should give you this P of epsilon. So how do we get an expression for the likelihood from this? Well, that works as follows. So what is this again? It's the probability, or probability density, that we find observations Y. The observation that we found, the probability that we find them, given that the atmospheric state is this value x. So we can write, we assume that the atmospheric state is this state x. So that's my x here. So the observation value that corresponds to that will be h of x, and then there's a measurement error, and that gives me the observation. But in this case, when we do the data simulation, the observations are known. The observations are done. I just want to know what the likelihood is. So we actually have to rewrite this equation as epsilon is y minus h of x, because we know y and we know x. We've chosen atmospheric state. I want to know what this probability is. So we know x, we know y. And so the difference between these two gives us this epsilon. And the question now is, okay, how likely is it to find this epsilon, this value of epsilon? But remember, we know it's probability density. For instance, when that probability density is Gaussian, as I've done here, then I know that P of epsilon is something like this, the exponent of epsilon, sort of epsilon squared, but written down here as a vector equation. Epsilon can be a vector because the observation can be a long vector. But it's just your standard Gaussian. And so the probability of finding this y given this state x is equal to the probability of finding this epsilon. And that is, I can just calculate that because I know P of epsilon. I know the probability density of epsilon. And then I just plug in what epsilon is. It is epsilon is y minus h of x. So there we are. So this is an expression for the likelihood in case the observation errors are Gaussian. But this is the way of thinking. So again, if you look in the literature, it's typically slightly confusing what people do there, but it is a sort of a two-step process. The first step is the actual measurement, what happens there. And the second is, okay, now these observations are given, and now we're going to use them in the data simulation. And then we get this likelihood. Okay, hope that wasn't too confusing. Now, so now what we're going to do is we're going to look at, okay, all very fine, we have this very general formalism. And again, if the computers would be big enough, we would have solved the daily simulation problem. But the computers are really small compared to what we need. You can do a simple calculation and you find that the number of atoms in the universe is just way, way, way too small to come even close to what we would need for to build the simple computer that we need for the data simulation problem. And so there's no way we can solve this unless maybe quantum computing. So we have to make approximations, that's the bottom line. And one of the approximations is that we say, well, let's assume that these probability densities are Gaussian. Let's assume that, that for instance, my model, the probability density of my model is a Gaussian distribution. And so I know my model is not perfect. So how good is it? Well, I represent that with the Gaussian, like in the second equation, which again is just the multivariate variant of univariate Gaussian that we're so familiar with. So this is my model probability density. And so this X is my model state. XB here is my best estimate, is the mean of the Gaussian, my best estimate of what the model state is. And this B here is a covariance matrix. Yeah? Again, the generalization of the simple variance. So this contains variances and covariance between the different variables in the state vectors. And again, state vector is in this generalized form. It can be a set of parameters, it can be all kinds of things. And then we have the likelihood, which again, we assume that the errors are Gaussian so that we get the expression that we had on the previous slide. Now, remember, what was data simulation? Data simulation was multiplying these two probability densities. So we're gonna multiply the P of X with the P of Y given X. Let's do that. So, of course, if this is a Gaussian and this is a Gaussian, I can write the product of the exponent S, and this is the part that comes from the prior, so from my model, from P of X, that's this part. And the second part here, you recognize the likelihood part. So we see that the posterior density, I know what it is, right? It's this thing over here. And why do we need data simulation? Well, I still don't know what it means, right? we still have to see what is the mean of this function? What is its covariance, for instance? Now, for the Kalman filter, and that's what we are going to move towards, we assume that everything is linear, is Gaussian, and also that this observation operator, this H, is a linear function. So effectively, if X is a vector, then H is just a matrix. And it again projects or maps the state to observation space. Again, if my observation is just one, measuring that one position, then this H of X takes my full concentration field and maps it to, in this case, takes out the value of the concentration at the position where I also have the measurement. So anyway, this is my posterior PDF. Now, the interesting thing is here that you see that this first term is quadratic in X. An X here and an X here. Remember, XB is given. An X here is the other X without index, is the variable. And the second part of the expression is also quadratic in X. There's an h of x here and an h of x there. So this is just the sum of two quadratic terms. And I can just add two quadratic terms. And again, I get again a quadratic term, quadratic form. Maybe. So I know that I can write this product something like this. And there will be an extra factor there that does not depend on x. And I just put that in the normalization. Again, we don't have to worry about normalization factors. So I know that my in the, for the Kalman filter in that case, when everything is Gaussian and H is linear, I can just immediately write down this expression. I know that the posterior is again a Gaussian. But now with the new mean XA and a new covariance P. And let's have a look at that. What is it? What is this XA? Well, if you do the derivation, you find that XA is equal to XB, and XB was the mean from the prior, so our best guess of the model state before we did the data simulation, so before we saw the observation, plus a correction term. And this correction term, if we start at the end, we see here y minus h of xb. So this is the difference between the observation and the model equivalent of that observation. So how close are these two guys, and the observation and what the model tells us for the observation? Then there is a factor here, it's an inverse of a matrix, and then we multiply by BHT. Okay, we come back to that in a second. I want to first move to this one. It is posterior covariance, as we call it. So it's the covariance after the data simulation. It's 1 minus k times h times b, a lot of equation. But b, remember, b is the error covariance of the prior, right, before we did the data simulation. And you see this is I minus kh, and indeed you can show that this posterior covariance is always smaller than the prior covariance. And if you want a more detailed and precise statement, is that the trace or the sum of the variances in P is always smaller than the sum of the variance in B. So we reduce the uncertainty. We always do that. Always, data simulation will always reduce the uncertainty. And this K here is this expression here, the so-called Kalman gain, the same thing is there. Now the important thing is to realize what these things mean. We have this equation, okay. What does it mean? So this is something called innovation, the difference between the observation and the model. This is a weighting factor. But this here is actually the most important part, perhaps, of what the data simulation does. Because on the one hand, it connects to observation. This part of the equation, the last part of the equation, is all in observation space. And it's only with this term we bring it back to state space. And through this B matrix, this B, like I said, was the covariance. So it tells you how things covary. And let me give you an example of that. And this error covariance is crucial in data simulations. That's why I want to spend slightly more time on it. So suppose we would have an observation here. This is an example of a data simulation in the Gaussian model, but it doesn't matter. I could have chosen anything, really, any model. This is a measurement of the sea surface height at this specific point in the red box. You recognize the Indian Ocean here with India here and then Indonesia over there, etc. And you see these contours here, and these contours tell us the correlation between the value at this point, this cross, and other points in the Indian Ocean. And the concentration is high close to that point, and then it drops off. And you see it drops off rapidly in the meridional direction, and drops off slowly in the zonal direction. Now this is a covariance that actually comes from an ensemble Kalman filter. But you see that this covariance has actually physical information, because we know if we look at the structure of the features at the equator in the ocean, we know that we have Kelvin waves there, and we know that they are much more elongated in the zonal direction than in the meridional direction. And so we see physics appearing in this covariance matrix. They tell us how different variables covary, and they contain physical knowledge about how these different variables are connected to each other. So the covariances are actually, these are the connections in the Kalman filter. These are the connection to the physics. That the rest is all mathematics, but this is where the physics is. And So these are two examples of different points. The first plot is, like I said, in the tropical Indian Ocean. This is in the Persian Gulf, where you see you have a different covariance structure, a different correlation structure. So coming back to the data simulation, suppose I do a measurement here of measurement of sea surface height. And so it's a pressure measurement. And then I correlate that with the sea surface temperature. So this y here, that's sea surface height, and this h of x takes from my full ocean model, it takes the sea surface height at that specific position, at the position of the cross. And then I do this weighting, etc. And then I have this term over here. And this term tells us how the information is spread out over the rest of the ocean domain. It is this covariance matrix, this covariance B. And so an XA again is my full atmosphere, my full, in this case, ocean model. So, but just with one observation of sea surface height, I changed my whole model field everywhere. But you see, it changes a lot close to the actual observation, because correlations are high. But if I, for instance, look at the area over here, there will be no update here, because there's the covariance is zero. So the correlation is zero. So the covariance is zero between what happens here and the point where I have my observation. And the interesting extension is that if you think about a common smoother, and we talk about that in a second, you can actually do this also over time. And now it becomes really exciting, right? So we do an observation at this specific position, and we can try to figure out, we can use the covariances in space, in this case in space and time, to see how that observation will affect what happened 2 days ago in, let's say, the position over here in the ocean. Again, we can do that through these covariance matrices. Now B would be a space-time covariance matrix. And so there's also time involved. And how do we do that? Well, I'll give you an example of an ensemble common filter and ensemble common smoothers. So the Kalman filter has this problem that these covariance matrices, they get huge. They are huge. If you think about an atmospheric model, at every time step, we have about 10 billion variables. So the covariance matrix is 10 to the 20th, right? It's we have no computer in the world that can store this many numbers. So we have to do something smarter. And one of the smart things is to use an ensemble common filter. So instead of propagating and even storing a covariance matrix, we just store and propagate a bunch of samples. So these are all, these dots here, each dot here is a full atmospheric state, or full chemical state of the atmosphere, if you like. Or, like I said, a vector of sinks and, let's not go there for this specific example. So, of course, when I have an ensemble, I can always calculate the sample mean, and I can calculate the ensemble covariance. So implicitly, these ensemble represent the Gaussian distribution, and that's indeed what ensemble common filters do. These samples represent the Gaussian distribution. And now, over time, I can just run each of these models forward in time with the full nonlinear model evolution. I don't have to linearize, which you would have to do if you use a pure common filter, but that's a detail for now. So we propagate these guys forward in time, and that gives me a new ensemble at a later time. And again, I can calculate the mean here of that ensemble and the covariance. And if there are observations, I can use the Kalman filter equations, but now in ensemble form, to update these ensemble members and to do the data simulation at this point. And that's exactly what ensemble common filters do. They propagate the covariance implicitly. They propagate it through this ensemble. And any time I can calculate that covariance matrix if I want to. And this specifically this term, the BHT term, I mentioned that is how things are spread out over the model domain. If I take all the ensemble members and I subtract the mean and I put that all in the matrix X, and this is time, this is a time T2. And so that could be, let's say, today. Then I can approximate this BHT by this combination over here. I'm not going to go into all the details of how you do it in ensemble common filters, but a very efficient way to do this. And this H of X means that you measure that state. And so this ensemble is in, the first ensemble here is in model space, in state space, And the second ensemble, we see this H operator, is actually an observation space. So this combination here gives me the connection between state and observation space, like I mentioned before in the example, the ocean example. And this is how you do it with the ensembles. But you very soon realize that, wait a minute, I can also do that. Yeah, look at observation space, that ensemble in observation space at time t2, and look at the correlation with the ensemble at t1, the ensemble over here. I can calculate that covariance, and with that covariance, I can update the states at this time, at the previous time, using observations at t2 from, let's say, today, update my states yesterday. So we can use these ensembles to propagate information forward and backwards in time. And there are many, many different variants of this. You have ensemble common smoothers, stochastic versions, square root versions, ensemble transform Kalman filter, ensemble adjustment Kalman filter, invented by Jeff Anderson at Ankar. There's a big zoo of different methods, and all they differ slightly, but the basic idea is all the same. They use these ensembles to calculate correlations, covariances between variable, so that we can update whole states with just one or a few observations. Now we need to talk about variational methods. And the variational methods are different. They look for the most probable state. So they look at the maximum of this probability density. And remember that we have this posterior probability density. Now in Kalman filters and ensemble Kalman filters that I just talked about, we assume that this is Gaussian. But the variational methods, we don't have to do that. What we do, we write it as, we write in this form. You can always do that as long as this probability density is smooth enough, you can do this. You can write it as 1/2 times some function j. And this j here, we call the cost function. And the interesting thing is that the maximum of this, of the left-hand side here of this equation, would correspond to the minimum of j. And that's because of this minus sign, right? And the smaller j is, and the closer it is to zero, and the closer this exponent is to one, so the larger this, the larger this expression is on the left-hand side. So j, so the maximum of the posterior of p of x corresponds to the minimum of j. And this j, well, look again let's assume again that our prior is Gaussian, so we get this term over here, and this is the likelihood that we've seen before. So this is now our cost function. And we're going to minimize this cost function. So we're going to, how do you minimize a function? Well, you put the derivative equal to zero. And then you find out where that happens, and then you have the position of the minimum. And in practice, we do that in an iterative way. And suppose here we have the model state, there should not be a subindex b here, because xb is a constant, but this should be the model state x. That's along the horizontal axis. On the vertical axis, we have this j, this cost function, and suppose that this, let's assume that this j looks like this orange curve here. And what we do in variational methods, and we do a so-called Gauss-Newton iteration. So we start at a certain state, our best guess, and we look at how much j is, and then we go iteratively downhill. So this is our second guess, and then we go further downhill, and then we iterate all the way until we get to the minimum. So it's an iterative scheme. Okay, so that's how the variational methods work. And I don't want to talk about this part now. But so in general, it just converts to the minimum of that function. And again, the minimum of j corresponds to the maximum of the posterior PDF. So that's the most likely state of the system given all these observations. And now there's actually an extension. So what I talked about now is so-called 3D var, 3D meaning only space. But there's also a thing called 4D var, which means that we include the time dimension. And so if we have time here on this axis, horizontal axis, and on the vertical axis, we have a model variable. So what we do in these filters, like Kalman filter and 3D var, we run the model forward until observation. Observation is the observation vector this time is represented by this cross here. And then here we do the daily simulation. So we push the model towards the observation using the daily simulation. And then we propagate the model forward in time again to the next observation time. And then again, we do daily simulation and we keep on doing that. And so we get these step-like updates every time we have observations. So that's so-called, this is a standard filter, like a Kalman filter or 3D VAR. That's what they do. But for atmospheric chemistry, much more interesting is a 4D VAR. And what the 4D VAR does in its most elementary form, it makes a forecast. Oops, sorry about that. It makes a full forecast. So over, so this blue line here is a forecast over a full assimilation window, which could be one day or it could be 2 weeks. Yeah? That order of magnitude, therefore, atmospheric chemistry, global model, you probably think about 1 or 2 weeks. Well, it depends on your what you're interested in, of course. And we have, again, the same observations, but now we're going to find a solution that takes all these the information from all these observations into account. And we typically want to update the initial state, so the initial concentration field, and maybe also, oh, by the way, for atmospheric chemistry, the evolution of the sources, the strength and perhaps the position of the different sources over time, over this whole window. So that's what we want to update. And so we're going to do this, what I just mentioned, this minimization, but now taking all these observations into account. And we get a solution, which is actually a so-called 4D solution, four-dimensional solution, as space and time. And we get this red line, this whole trajectory is now the solution. And if you look at the mathematics of this, I'm sorry about to bring it up again, but you must get, and by now sort of get used to the stuff that we have there. Again, we can write a cost function. We have our prior, and in this case, I'm just looking at the initial condition, but again, this could be more general. And we have the observation part, but now there's a summation here because we have observations at different times. And suppose we have observations at m different times, then you get, for each of them, you get an expression like we had before for the likelihood. And the slight complication that is h here, this what I call the observation operator, is now slightly more complicated because this x here is the state at time zero. And this y here is the observation at time, let's say ty. So what is this? Well, that means that this h operator needs to contain the model. So hi here, h subindex I of x, what does it mean? It means I take my atmospheric state at time zero. I propagate it forward from time zero to time I with my model, with the atmospheric model, the atmospheric chemistry model. And then I do my actual measurement and compare to the observations. And so the hi contains a bit more now. It also contains my full model integration. And again, we solve this in an iterative way. Now, okay, there's a long introduction, which of course took a lot more time than I had hoped. But how do we include transport errors in 4D VAR? And if you look in literature, we see, for instance, Howling et al. And I mentioned this because Howling is an old friend of mine from Utrecht. And we can include them in the observation error covariance. So people have included them in the observation error covariance. And so this observation error covariance now contains actually three parts. One is the measurement error. I did mention that before. The other part I didn't talk about is a representation error. That is well known also in atmosphere chemistry. In short, there will be, we have a model grid box of, let's say, 200 by 200 kilometers by I don't know, 500 meter high. And we have a point measurement or an almost point measurement from a device. So there's a difference in scale between the observation and the model. And the model cannot represent the scale of the observations. So there's a so-called representation error that has to do with the different, in this case, different resolution of the model and the observations. There are different kinds of representation errors. This is one of them. And then we have the error in the transport. And the fact that the winds in my atmospheric model that I use in my atmospheric chemistry model are not perfect. there are errors in there. So we can try to put that in the observation error. But this, of course, is a slightly strange space for a transport error to appear, because we know that the transport is related to the observation operator. And so it's this thing. This is where the model is. So this is where my atmospheric winds are. So the transport errors are actually hidden in this observation operator and not so much in R. So how should we think about this? And again, if you look at the literature, there's some confusion. And recently there's a paper last year where they tried to introduce this kind of errors, these transport errors, and they started from the posterior PDF, but then it becomes quite messy. And the way to do this is you start from the likelihood, because that's where you compare model and observation. So that's where this observation operator is. And then I'm using here, in this first step, I'm using a trick from, again, probability theory. I just say, well, I can see this distribution as the marginal distribution of the joint one between the observations and this H operator. And remember, the H operator is now uncertain. Yeah? And that's because there's uncertainty in the wind. Like I said, that uncertainty is reflected in the H operator. So we can write the likelihood in this way. I can expand it, if you like. I can add an extra variable, H, here. But then I'm also, at the same time, integrating over all possible H's. So I sort of integrate it out again, and then I get the likelihood back. But as soon as I have this joint PDF, I can do the same thing as I did before. I can write it as a conditional PDF and the marginal. Right? So this y and h are now two variables, and writing that y given h and h itself. And the whole thing, of course, is still conditioned on my state x. Now, if we assume, again, Gaussian measurement and representation errors, so not transport errors, but measurement and representation errors, because these are things that happen at the observation time. So we're going to extract them from this formalism. Then I can say, okay, if H is given, then I only have these kind of errors. Yeah? So meaning as H is given, meaning, like I said, if I would know what the transport is, then I get here my standards. This is just the standard likelihood as we've seen before. And funny enough, and you see the interesting part is still this expression over here, the probability of this observation operator given the state. And if we assume that this is Gaussian, then indeed I get what many people have been using. You just add an error to the observations. But is that actually realistic in our case? That's the question. I'm going to show you something here, which which is about how this wind and the observation operator, how they are actually connected. So let's assume that x is a vector of emissions. And so we want to know p edge of x, so that the probability of the observation operator is given the vector of emissions, right? That's the thing we want. And like I said, the uncertainties in the observation operator come from uncertainties in the transport and the wind. So suppose my emissions give me an uncertainty cloud, so a plume of a certain chemical species over here, like this here. And assume in this first line here that the wind is relatively low, so small wind, and the wind is small. And I'm going to look at what happens when I do a measurement at this place here. So the x is my measurement location. And on the horizontal here, in this part here, I have space here as horizontal. So this is just the measurement at a certain point. Now you see when and a certain time, of course. And the time is given by t is big T. So when I do this specific measurement, I see I'm actually measuring my plume before it's really there, right? So I find low concentrations. The bulk of the plume, if you like, is still upwind from where I do my measurement. So I see that low wind, so if the winds are small, then I get low concentrations. And now assume the other case when we have a very high wind. Again, I do the same observation at the same space and time point, And now, oh, the plume is already passed, has already passed me because the wind was so strong. So again, I see that high wind correlates again with low concentration. So both low wind and high wind correspond to low concentrations. But if I now have a medium wind, then I see in this case, I measure exactly in the middle of the plume. So I see a high concentration. So medium wind correlates with high concentration. And that's where the difficulty is. Yeah, there's a nonlinear relation between the strength of the wind and the concentration that I will measure. Yeah, because the plume will just blow over me, and it really depends on when I do my measurement. Sorry, it really depends on the strength of the wind. Yeah, the measurement time is fixed. The strength of the wind, what I'll see in my measurement. And this is only one dimensional example, right? In reality, it's of course two or actually even three dimensional. So it's even much more complicated than this, but this is just a simple example. So what does that mean? If I now plot here on the horizontal axis, the strength of the wind, and so low winds here, high winds there, and intermediate winds and medium winds here. And I look at the concentration that I see at that specific time t. And remember, I find low concentration with low winds and low concentration with high winds. And I only find high concentration, so I'm somewhere up here, for the medium winds. So the connection between the wind and the concentration, you see it's highly non-Gaussian. It's this weird shape, the green shape here. And if I would a typical Gaussian relation would be these dashed lines here, right? The dashed contours. And so an ellipse, that's what the Gaussian would do. But you see, this is not an ellipse, this is a banana, right? It's really something else. So this complicated the data simulation and makes it more nonlinear. Non-Gaussian and nonlinear are actually quite similar in this case. And there's another error in or difficult non-Gaussianity, if you like, and that comes from chemical reactions. Now I just give you an example here of three reactions. A reacts with B to form C, and then A together with C forms D, and then D, C and D form E. That's just a very simple example. And I assume here that A is Gaussian distributed, and so this species is Gaussian distributed at this position, and B is also Gaussian distributed, and they are independent. And so I have uncertainty in A and uncertainty in B represented by that Gauss. And I just run this. And then I look at, okay, what is now the relation between species E and species A? So E is here, A is there. And when I look at that, you see, again, I get this another kind of banana here. Again, not a Gaussian shape, just because of these chemical reactions. And we build up correlations between these different variables, and they interact with each other. And we have all this chemistry going on, and this is just three equations, right? And if you look at your ozone scheme, it can even be more than 50 equations all connected to each other. So there will be even more. So the chemical reactions are by their very nature always nonlinear, and they can give rise to highly nonlinear structures again in the probability densities. So it means that the Gaussian methods do not necessarily work. So how do we solve that? And I'm realizing I'm running over time. I just want to mention two things. So in ensemble common filters and common smoothers, we can actually add these transport errors. We can add them as soon as we do the model integrations. So for these methods, as far as I can see, we can build that in these methods. Of course, these methods then assume that everything is Gaussian, so we're not going to get the right answer. But we know that we can extend these methods to include these transport errors, and in principle, solve it in that approximate way, still using the Gaussian assumption, but things are non-Gaussian. The 4D VAR, that will be more complicated. We can use the so-called reconstrained 4D VAR, which tend to be expensive. or we can run an ensemble of 4 devices, and each of them have a different transport. This is not a strange thing, an ensemble of 4 devices. This is ESMWF, the weather prediction center in Europe. They do this routinely, and every 12 hours they run an ensemble of 4 devices for the numerical weather prediction. So you can also use that for the chemistry in principle. And of course, if you're really keen, and of course we are, to solve this non-Gaussian problem, then we have to do nonlinear daily simulation. There are few methods out there that becoming more and more mature. So Jeff has this very nice marginal adjustment rank histogram filter, I should say. And there's local particle filters out there. There are particle flows that have been developed. So there are methods, nonlinear methods are slowly coming, maturing, and could be of use. So I'm not going to talk about this and all this. But just to conclude then, I hope I convinced you that data simulation theory is simple, but developing practical scheme is complicated. Bayes' theorem is very simple. Deriving a 4D var is slightly more complicated. And if you look at the nitty-gritty of a 4D var, it becomes quite a complicated beast. Transport errors, chemistry, model errors. I didn't include errors in the boundary layer height, for instance. They will lead to nonlinear and non-Gaussian structures when you do chemical data simulation. Existing schemes can be extended to solve these problems in an approximate way, and nonlinear methods are being developed. And the final thing is, if we get this chemical data simulation, if we manage to do that properly, that's really important for the numerical weather prediction tool. If you can do this fully coupled, man, then the chemistry will tell us so much about the weather, about winds and radiation fields, etc. But the main obstacles for that is the size of the problem will be tremendous, and the covariances between the relations between the physical variables and the chemical variables will typically be highly non-Gaussian. So sorry for overrunning, but this is all I have. Thank you for your attention.
All right. Thanks, Peter. So now we're going to transition to the Slido. So if you have questions, please be sure to enter them into Slido and get them submitted. So there's a little delay while people type them out, get them approved. So while we're waiting, I actually have a follow-on question for what we were just talking about here with the, oh, never mind. We've already got one.
Okay.
Perfect. I'll step away.
Okay. So Jeff asks, you work on the extending particle filters seem perfect for this type of application. Are there any of those methods ready for testing in atmospheric chemistry application at this point? Now, so that's a very good question, Jeff. Thank you for that. So indeed, we're working on particle flows. We have tested them now in quasi-geostrophic models. So these are atmospheric models that simplified dynamics. Seems to work really well. They're extremely useful for highly nonlinear situations, bimodal distributions. It can all handle all that. Is it ready for atmospheric chemistry at this point? No, it's not. But as soon as we manage to build that into, for instance, the DART framework, then I think we can actually we can have a look. Yeah? And of course, yeah. Anyway, so that's. The slightly difficult thing is that a particle filter is a filter, but for the atmospheric chemistry, a smoother is much more useful. And I can ask you another question about that, Jeff. Is your rank histogram filter, is that actually, do you have a smoother version? That would be good. Anyway, Chris Snyder asks, suppose you were considering estimation of both meteorology, so the winds and the traces together. How would that change your view of transport errors? Thank you, Chris. So transport errors would I think we probably wouldn't call them errors, we call them uncertainty in the winds. And but there's no, in principle, there's no there's no difference. And so what I mentioned before, you can do a 40 var metrology and tracers, estimating both the metrology and the atmosphere, and the chemistry or tracers. In this case, like for 40 var, you would have to do reconstrained 40 var, but you need an estimate, a prior estimate of these errors, meaning that you need to know their statistics. And of course, what's the error in the wind field is a difficult question, eh? But you start with, if you, for instance, run an ensemble scheme, and you start with some uncertainty in the wind at time zero, and then you let your ensemble run forward in time, and that gives you a whole ensemble of realizations of the wind field. But there's no, I don't think it would change my view of transport errors specifically. If that makes sense.
I'll let some folks continue to submit questions if they have any. Maybe I can follow up on that and ask a short question. So my guess, but you can tell me if I'm wrong, certain types of chemical and aerosol species probably are going to be better constrained by DA, in part because of their covariance with local meteorology. I'm thinking, like, we have a volcanic eruption going on right now. Volcanic aerosols have local heating perturbations that accompany them. So does that actually mean that those species are more amenable to being constrained by DA, or is that sort of two-way interaction going to appear in the equations?
Well, so it depends a bit how you do this. I think the standard methods is still doing the atmosphere, chemistry data simulation offline. Eh? So you get a wind field, and then you do it. And the so in that sense, the heating would give you just a different atmospheric field there, if it can actually resolve that. Would these variables be more constrained? I think not necessarily. It really depends on what you're actually measuring, in combination with how good your prior information is on the specific variable. Of course, the difficulty is, again, take ozone as an example. If you really want to do the whole ozone thing, there's 50 or more equations. It's very complicated, and we definitely cannot constrain everything that's in there very accurately. We only have a few measurements of these things, and then we don't have the space-time resolution of these observations that we really like. So that is a problem. The thing is that we, in principle, no matter how many observations you have and how big the uncertainty is, you can in principle do the data simulation and get a result out of that. And it just means that, okay, we are just highly uncertain. But this is all the information that we have. This is the answer. Given these observations with their errors, and given this model, this prior model with its uncertainty, this is the solution. And that's why it's so important that we always try to use a data simulation method that comes with an approximate estimate of the errors, because only then you're doing science. You say, okay, it's this value, but the uncertainty is really large. So actually, I don't know that well, or the uncertainty is really small. I know pretty well what's going on here. So I see a question by Armand, and the question is, do you think machine learning methods, deep neural networks, convolutional neural networks, etc., can help these non-Gaussian problems? And the answer is yes and no. This is a very interesting question, actually. There's a lot to say. I'll try to be brief. So machine learning, the first thing is you have to train your machine, right? And you have to do the basic training. And even if your machine is later on is adaptive, yeah, you need that basic training. So that can be difficult to get enough data to learn to train the machine. But the good thing is that you can train on input and output, and you don't have to worry about how the input was transformed to the output, and you just let the machine do it. And machine learning people try to even replace the whole data simulation system with machines, and just a whole bunch of local machines to do the global macro weather prediction. So people are thinking along those lines. So in principle, machines are very good for these non-Gaussian problems. There are all kinds of more difficult things in the machines. So they need a lot of training data. That's one thing. And the other thing is that typically the output space is relatively low dimensional. So you need a lot of machines, and you need to think really hard on what is the input for each of the different machines to get useful output. And the other thing that's connected to this is that if you look at machine learning, if you look at the training phase, they use essentially a 4D var, and or 3D var, it depends on how you look at it. Well, let's call it a 4D var. And so they're using the same, they're using similar methods as you use in data simulation. And recently people realized, well, if we can use a 4D var to train a machine, we can also use it on some more common filter to train a machine. And indeed, that's possible. And it actually turns out to be, for certain problems at least, very efficient, much more efficient than the stochastic gradient descent that people use in machine learning. So these two fields they can learn a lot from each other. And indeed, for these non-Gaussian problems, there's definitely a lot of things that can help, how they can help each other. Here's another example. The data simulation, the particle flow that I mentioned, I didn't really talk about it, but we use techniques from machine learning inside that methodology. So it is a what we call standard data simulation method, but we use techniques from machine learning like kernel embedding and all kinds of stuff to help indeed solve these non-Gaussian problems. So Ben then asks, are there new ways to efficiently assimilate observations with an ensemble smoother of reduced size, let's say 10 to 30 members? Atmospheric chemistry is computational expensive. Yeah, so this touches on a very complicated problem with ensemble methods. So indeed, can we do a very small number of ensemble members and still do assimilate observations and let's say update the sources 2 days back? And that's difficult. We need, so for these common filter-based methods and also the 4D var, these methods stand or fall with the quality of this covariance matrix. I try to explain how important the covariance matrix was. And if the covariance matrix if you don't have a good approximation to that covariance matrix, then the method will fail. And if you only have 30 or 10 ensemble members to estimate the covariance matrix in a, let's say, a high dimensional space, yeah, let's say 1,000, 10,000, 100,000, a billion, that will be a poor approximation to that covariance matrix. So people in the data simulation field have come up with a technique called localization. And that more or less says, well, if I want to update what happens at these grid points, I'm not going to look at the whole globe and what's happening there. I'm only going to look at observations that are close to this grid point. So I reduce the size of the problem dramatically. And that means that the ensemble, a small ensemble, can still do a reasonable job to estimate this covariance matrix. So I can get a good answer. And this is done in the macro weather prediction, for instance. Now the difficulty with atmospheric chemistry is that it's typically a problem where we want a solution over time. A source at a certain point, if you want to estimate the source strength, it doesn't have an immediate influence on the concentration at this moment. And there's time involved. You need 2 days for things to evolve and then do the measurement and then figure out how strong the source was. So then you have to do localization in space and time. Okay, because again, you have to compare an ensemble at present time, and you have to compare that with the ensemble and the same ensemble, but that same ensemble 2 days back, where I and that ensemble then contains the emissions. So if you try to think about localization, it becomes a complicated problem, because the plume from the emission, it moves around the globe. It's transported with the atmospheric flow, and that means that what is local, it becomes complicated. So we do not have good methods for that. One thing which you could do is to build up this localization idea indeed over space-time, where the localization area is propagating with the flow. There's some quite advanced ideas out there, and people have tested it, and in some cases it works pretty well. So are there new ways? The answer is yes and no. we're moving in that direction, but it is I wouldn't say that that's a solved problem. And it has to do mainly with this localization. That is a difficult problem over space and time. Risto, good hearing for you. So the question is, assuming that sources or sinks of chemical species are negligible compared to advection effects, would it be possible to accurately estimate the chemical portion of the state with wind measurements only? Okay, so the question is, okay, let's forget about sources and sinks. We're just transporting stuff around and having the difficult chemical species have their interactions. And we only estimate the wind. We only measure the wind. Can we estimate the chemical portion of the state? So I assume the concentration fields of the different variables. Can we do that? In principle, if we have a good starting point, so if let's say at a certain point in time, we have a good estimate of concentration of the different species is, then if we just have very accurate measurements of the wind, we can in principle come up with an estimate of the chemical composition at different points in space and time. But of course, we need to rely heavily on the model, on the chemical model, so that part of the evolution at a certain point, and the evolution of the chemical component depends on two things. It depends on the chemistry, and it depends on the wind, what's it vectored in. So if the chemistry is very accurate in the model, then by just measuring the wind, you could estimate that. And indeed, if you think about an ensemble data simulation method, you build up this correlation between species concentration and the wind. So in principle, you could do this, but of course, there are all kinds of errors with these models, both in the chemistry, scavenging, raining out, boundary layer height, entrainment. I mean, there's all kinds of issues that are very difficult. And I mentioned these, so these are sort of there are many things that are parameterized in your atmospheric model. So yeah, if you only have wind measurements, then you depend on the accuracy of the parameterizations in the atmospheric models. Okay, so one of the biggest challenges in chemical data simulation is the large uncertainty in emission data, which is a forcing parameter. What do you think will be the best way to deal with that in the traditional Kalman filter algorithms? Yeah, so like I mentioned, right? So the concentration at a certain point in space and time is not instantaneously connected to, of course, the emission. And there's evolution over there, let's say two, three days a week, whatever. So a traditional Kalman filter does, of course, is a filter. So it tries to it use all the observation from the past up till now, and then gives you the best estimate of the state. And so the pure Kalman filter cannot update the emissions in the past given the present observations. It will try to estimate the emissions at this time, but the relation between these variables isn't really there. The emission at this time is not directly connected to the concentrations at this time. So you would have to extend the state vector, as we said in Kalman filtering. So the Kalman filter would now have in the state, in this x what you estimate, you would have the concentration field, space and time, and you would extend that with the strength of the emissions. And the and then you would run the Kalman filter, and the Kalman filter will build up during the evolution of the system. It will build up correlations or covariances between the emissions, even if they were in the past, and the state at the present moment. So you could in principle do that. You can extend your state vector with elements variables that you want to know in the past, and so you sort of you're perhaps cheating a bit, but again you use the same kind of idea as you use in the Kalman smoother, that you build up these space-time covariances, and in this case it's just emission data and concentrations at different times. But in principle you can do this. So Kazu asks, is there any publication on your GeoSchem Tomcat chemistry data simulation results? Thank you for your nice talk. Well, thank you. So the thing is, I've never done any atmospheric chemistry data simulation. Perhaps I should have started that. But then I would have lost all of you, perhaps. So I know about data simulation, and I've worked with people doing atmospheric data simulation. So no, there's no paper that I'm involved with, but there are many, many good papers out there that, that I could point you to in principle. I can point you to have a look what people are doing. But yeah, you can just go to the GeoSchem or the Tomcat webpage and find publication there. That's probably the fastest way.
All right. Wow. Thanks everyone for all of the questions. That was a really great discussion. Let's thank Peter again. Peter, thank you very much for coming and talking to us. And I think I can say, at least I learned a great deal about the fundamentals of DA. And again, thanks very much for your time today. We really appreciate it.
Yeah, so thank you. And I hope this was useful, right? Because like I said, I went to the fundamentals, to the beginning. And hopefully, the thing is, as soon as you get that, then all these data simulation methods, it's easy to understand. And unless you have that overview, it remains sort of a bit unclear. And you make mistakes. Where should I put this kind of error? And people do make mistakes in the literature. They put errors in the wrong place, and it doesn't really work. Anyway, I enjoyed it too, and it was great. And we should definitely keep in touch.